BAM!
Mr. Taru, in this math lesson, we are going to be showing you how to find areas of parallelograms. But not just this simple little sort of geometric version here that we have in a 2D plane, something you would have done a couple years ago in geometry. Nope, I'm just going to use this example to help you see what's going on in these formulas that actually have more than just one use, more than just the use of finding the area of a parallelogram when that parallelogram has vertices that are denoted by three-dimensional space, so each of these vertices has an x, y, and z component, or if two sides of your parallelogram are defined by a vector, and our example is going to be a vector in component form that is in three-space. So let's get this out of the way for just a second and look at these definitions here. The magnitude of the vector, which is a result of doing the cross product between vector u and v, is the magnitude of that cross product vector, or vector cross product, is equal to the magnitude of vector u times the magnitude of vector v times the sine of theta, where theta is the angle between the two vectors. Now, it looks very similar to the formula that we worked with, not exactly the same, but it is similar to that formula that we learned and that you should be memorizing for finding the geometric definition for the dot product between two vectors, or that formula that we used for finding the angle between two vectors. So it's similar, but don't get confused. Now, that definition for the magnitude of the vector, which is the cross product of two other vectors, leads us into the geometric definition of a cross product, which is that the cross product between vector u and v is equal to the magnitude of vector u times the magnitude of vector v times the sine of theta. Now, you'll see this is in parentheses, and it's in front of this vector n, which is a normal vector. So, and it's a unit vector. So we have vector I is a unit vector in the direction of the x-axis, vector j is a unit vector in the direction of the y-axis, vector k, unless your textbook has uses different symbols or letters, is our unit vector in the direction of the z-axis, and n is a unit vector which is normal or orthogonal, perpendicular, if you will, to both vectors u and v. Now, we just talked about this in our previous lesson. I gave you this diagram and we talked about the properties of the cross product. And when you do a cross product between vector v and u, you get a vector which is again orthogonal to, or you may say perpendicular, to the two vectors that you did the cross product of. So the cross product gives us a vector. That new vector is orthogonal to the two original vectors that you ran through the process of taking the cross product. So vector u crossed with vector v is an opposite, or would give you an opposite vector, as opposed to if you did vector u, vector v crossed with vector u. So when you change the order of your cross product notation, you are going to get an opposite vector. So be careful with the order that you write this notation when you're doing a problem about cross products. So if a question says, find the cross product vector u cross with vector v, don't, for some reason, accidentally write vector v cross with vector u, because you will get opposite answers, or an opposite vector, a vector with the same magnitude, so that's going to be important here in a second, but in the opposite direction. Now, when you talk about this magnitude formula, yes, if you're looking at the cross product, the vector you get from the cross product process, that order makes a difference. You know, they're going to be opposite vectors, but they will have the same magnitude. So in terms of magnitude, remember, the magnitude of a vector in component form is the square root of a squared plus b squared plus c squared, or u sub 1 squared plus u sub 2 squared plus u sub 3 squared, if you're in 3 space. You're taking each of those components and you're squaring them first and adding them. Well, the squaring process is going to take care of any kind of positive negativeness you have between these two vectors on those components. So the order which you write vector u cross with vector v cross with vector u, changes your answer for the actual vector, but it will not change your answer for the magnitude. And you can see here, while this formula is presented as the magnitude of your vector cross product, I finally said it right the first time. If you go through the process of finding the vector cross product, it's not a big deal. Like I just said the formula out loud, and we've done it now for quite a few sections of work. It's pretty easy to find the magnitude of a vector. So while this formula is the magnitude of the vector cross product, it helps us develop this geometric definition, but it's not really something that we use necessarily in our homework chart too much. We are going to use this formula though. We're going to see part of this formula in our formula for finding the area of a parallelogram. So I'm going to take the simple geometric problem we would have had a couple of years ago and said, you know, what is the area of this parallelogram ABCD? Well, what is the process for finding the area of a parallelogram? It's the base times the height. So you would drop a perpendicular down here and say, okay, well, we need to find the height of this parallelogram. Set up a little temporary right triangle and say that we have the sine of 60 degrees is equal to the opposite side over the hypotenuse. And I'm talking about just this little right triangle here, so the hypotenuse is 4. And the height of this parallelogram is going to be 4 times the sine of 60 degrees. So if I want to set up the area and figure out the area of this parallelogram, it's going to be the length of the base times 4 times the sine of 60. Now that little bit of simple right triangle trig and knowledge that we learned from geometry, check out what's going on over here. The area of this parallelogram is equal to 7. Well, what does that represent here? It's the length of AD. And if I come through here and I say, you know what? How about this is vector AB and this is vector AD? Well, then what you're seeing here is that the area of this parallelogram is 7, which is the magnitude of vector AD, times 4, which is the magnitude of vector AB, times the sine of 60 degrees. So what you're about to see in the next page of notes and in the formula that I use in the one example we're doing in this video, magnitude of a vector times the magnitude of a vector times the sine of the angle between those two vectors, while that is the formula for finding the magnitude of the vector cross product, it's also going to be our formula for finding the area of a parallelogram. Not a nice simple one like this that we can just do in 2D space and just use our basic knowledge of geometry, but if our vertices, are defined as 3 space coordinates, or that we're just given a couple of vectors define a couple of sides of our parallelogram, we can just run through this process quite easily of working out the vector cross product and then taking the magnitude of that vector and having the area of the parallelogram. Maybe a situation here wouldn't be quite so simple to work with just a simple base times height. No. So here we go. Given a parallelogram, ABCD, if vector U is equal to vector AB, which is equal to vector DC, you know, the opposite sides of your parallelogram are basically congruent and parallel, then and you also have vector V is equal to vector AD, which is equal to vector BC, then the area of your parallelogram is simply the magnitude of your vector cross product. Now you know where the formula came from. It wasn't a proof, but kind of showed you the geometry in the previous scene. Hence, the area of triangle ABC, so if you just, you know, cut this parallelogram in half, you would have the area of a triangle. And this is just a summary of that diagram from the previous page of notes. So our example that we're going to work through, we're going to find the area of the parallelogram ABCD with vector AB defined as the three-dimensional vector, -3, 1, 0, and vector BC in component form, this column format here, going along the direction of the x, y, and z axis for negative 2 and 1. Now, I'm not going to try and draw this in exact sort of three-dimensional space. That'd be really difficult in this flat chalkboard, but I am going to just say, okay, well, just to give me something to look at, just do a little quick here sketch and just say this is A and B. And then we have from B to C. And then we have D. Okay, so we have this vector here given. And this vector right here, defined by a couple of vectors. And to find the area of this parallelogram, we're just going to do the cross product between those two vectors. Find that vector cross product, find that new vector, find its magnitude. That will be the area of this parallelogram. So let's start off here. We have the area of ABCD is going to be equal to the magnitude of vector AB crossed with BC. So if you were a little sketchy on your cross product work, we're just going to run through a nice example. Take the magnitude of that vector cross product and have our area of this parallelogram. Formula for finding cross product, quite a bit long. So instead of trying to remember that, we're going to remember something else. We're going to set up a 3x3 matrix with our first matrix here first in the second row. Our second matrix in the cross product in our second row, and the order matters when you're finding that vector cross product. Ultimately, we're just going to find its magnitude. So again, kind of doesn't matter the order in which you do this in terms of I want to just simply find the magnitude, but it is important to get used to that and be careful. Know that you have to be careful with that notation for finding a vector cross product, because those vectors, if you write that in the wrong order one more time, will be opposite vectors. So we're going to be finding the magnitude of this vector cross product. So we're going to take out the row and column that has the notation or the unit vector of I and say that we're going to take the determinant of this little 2x2 here, 1, negative 2, 0, 1, minus the determinant. We're going to set up a little 2x2 matrix by taking out the row and column where our J vector, unit vector, is at. We're going to have a little 2x2 of negative 3, 4, 1, 0, 1, plus the determinant. We're going to take out a little 2x2 matrix when we remove the row and column that includes the unit vector in the direction of the Z axis, or the K vector. So we have negative 3, 4, 1, and negative 2. I often forget this negative sign if I try and go right to the vector notation. Multiply down, multiply up. So 1 times 1 is 1, minus negative 2 times 0, which is 0, minus. Again, multiply down, multiply up, positive down, negative up. Negative 3 times 1 is negative 3, minus 4 times 0 is 0, plus. Now this determinant down to the right, negative 3 times negative 2, positive 6. Minus, going up, 4 times 1 is 4. Now I'm going to write this as a column unit vector, or unit vector in column form. Pause for the phone. Okay, so we got the phone. We got 1 minus 0 is, of course, 1. We have negative 3 minus 0 is negative 3, but then it's going to get multiplied by negative because we're subtracting that determinant, so we have a positive 3. And then 6 minus 4, of course, is 2. We're going to find the magnitude of this vector, which is going to be equal to, so basically we're looking at the area of our parallelogram is equal to the square root of the x component, or the component going in the direction of the x-axis, component going in the direction of the y-axis squared. So we have 3 squared and finally 2 squared. And we're looking at the square root of 1 plus 9 plus 4. We're looking at the square root of 14 square units. And now you have two ways of finding the area of a parallelogram. That old school geometric method, and now a new process you can go through if your vector or if your parallelogram is defined with a couple of vectors, or the vertices are in 3 space, makes it a lot easier. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.